Lord and cost me great, I'll walk for you.
That you have given to your children. We thank you for how you have kept us healthy and well. Lord, we are praying and asking this morning that even through our carelessness, through ignorance, we will not put our health and the health of our entire household in jeopardy in Jesus' name. Righteous God, we know that your will is that we prosper and we have sound health to be able to enjoy that prosperity even as we prosper, my Lord, spiritually And we are praying that this will that you have for each and every one of your children, you will make it a reality in every life in Jesus' name. The principles from your word that changes our attitude, shine the light on it this morning and open our hearts of understanding to receive what you have prepared for us this morning. Spirit of the living God, come and have your place again and let your name be glorified. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. And the church of God says,
amen.
Amen. Turn with me, if you will, as we begin, to 3 John. I read here in verse 2. 3 John, I read in verse 2. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. This morning, as I talk to you on the believer's illness and wellness, the question comes to mind, why preach on this subject of illness? I thought we are covenant people of God, and we have the covenant of healing and health. Why are we preaching about illness? Oh, the answer for this is simple. It is because though we have the covenant of healing, we have the covenant of wealth, but yet Christians still get sick. I don't know the church where the Christians in that church don't fall sick at all. In other words, every believer is not immune from disease or sickness. And it is important we understand that. Oh, we have faith. Oh, yes, we have the promise of God. Oh, yes, we have the covenant of God that can never fail. Oh, thank God for it. But you still find Christians falling sick. There is no such thing as a Christian that receive that go directly to heaven past all suffering card. You know, there are some Christians that believe that there is a card once you become born again. And God gives you that card. And what does that card say? It's simple. Go directly to heaven. Pass all suffering. I have not received it. Because I still suffer some things. And no Christian has received that kind of card. And it is in the light of this that we need to talk about this. Disease is democratic. Every believer will be sick at one point or the other because we are all vulnerable to sickness. But this is one area where Christians, maybe as a result of faith, uninformed faith, we are not taking it seriously enough. The children, the world, is very, very far ahead of the church. The church waits for the problem to happen and we begin to pray about it because we think that, oh, prayer will solve every problem. The church will not take adequate, you know, care sometimes of their health, thinking that, well, I trust God. God is still in the business of doing miracles. But you will find the world, they are smarter, they are wiser when it comes to this subject matter. They are doing what they needed to do. When they need to go to medical checkup, they do. When they do need to make research, they do. And we, the church too, there is nothing wrong in us to be careful about this health that God has given us. There's nothing that God gives us. If we are not careful about it, we will lose it. That is number one. The second thing is that the way we show that we care about whatever we have is to look after it. That is the only thing. Whatsoever we have, If we care for it, we look after it, by all means, we will not lose that thing. And that's why the Bible tells us, when Christ was speaking, that Christians should live wisely, circumspectly, and not as fools. There are many times when we do a lot of binding and losing. We embark on that things that are not necessary most times because we left it to be too late. At other times, it is even not necessary. Somebody is sick, and the sickness is the sickness that natural thing has caused and natural thing can solve. Then we don't have to be looking for the supernatural. It is like wasting resources. When you know that, okay, I have headache, Panadol will cure it. And now we are turning it into binding and losing. There are some people in some churches, even when they see cockroaches in their house, they are not looking at how clean or how tidy the house is. They begin to bind. I bind you that cockroach. Don't bind cockroach. If you have cleaned the house very well, you will not see rats. You will not see cockroaches. There's nothing that they see. Many Christians sometimes think everything has the spiritual to it. If I don't clean my house, if I don't tidy up my kitchen, by all means, if crumbs of things are all over the place, hands will by all means be around. But some Christians, once they see hands in their house that they've never seen before, they may fast and pray because of it, because they thought that it's coming from the devil. No. And it's important. There are many bindings and losings that we embark on that are not necessary because they are natural solutions that God has provided for us to be able to solve that. What natural solution can do, the supernatural should be left alone. If you apply it, it's superfluous. It's unnecessary. And it's important. Think about it. Dizziness that comes as a result of anemia, dizziness that happens as a result of high blood pressure, some point joint pain, and so on and so forth, can be eliminated through appropriate diet and exercise. It is simple. Well, I'm feeling dizzy. When you are feeling dizzy and you know that maybe it is because you are stressed, give yourself some rest. If you are feeling, high blood pressure, you have high blood pressure because you have been worrying too much about things you shouldn't be worrying about, then you need to sit back. Some natural things will take care of all those things. Oh, my high blood pressure is very high. For that reason, I'm binding and losing. My friend, don't bind and lose. Look for what natural problem can solve. It is possible. Brother Festus is here. I use his case as an example for us to know that there are some sicknesses that we don't need to be binding and to be losing. He suffered high blood pressure. And they went to the hospital. And he was using medication. But suddenly, Sister Ali started preparing this drink. In fact, that agbo is very good. And bro was drinking that drink regularly. They went back. They told me that they went back to the hospital. And guess what? The doctor told him, don't use that your medicine again. You are all right. You are fine. I can see. I have tested you over and over again. You are all right. We didn't bind. We didn't lose. He didn't continue and say that, they have given me this medicine. I will continue to use it for life. This natural thing, garlic there, the other one there, ginger there, and they mix it and just be drinking it. That's all. He could leave that and say, no, I won't drink this. I will be drinking malt. Some people will like to drink Coke because that one is sweet in the mouth. While he's destroying the health, brethren, the Lord will help us. These are practical things. I want to talk to you practically this morning. And the reason is because if the Lord is going to grant unto us an open door in the new year, if your health is failing, even if they give you work at the PM's office, you cannot do the work. We've heard the story of a Nigerian president. Is it money that was his problem? No. But he died in sickness. We know about how a Nigerian president, why I mention Nigeria is that they can take all the money in that country to themselves again, nothing will happen. To themselves alone, and nothing will happen. He came here for 6 months. They said Buhari was in this country because of failing health. If health fails, it doesn't matter the opportunities that are around us. And I am trusting God that none of our health will fail in Jesus' name. Brethren, some illness as a result of lack of vitamin C and vitamin D. And when we have those vitamins and we are doing appropriate exercises and we are eating the right kind of food, those problems will be all right. In these areas of diet, the exercise, the children of this world are wiser than the children of light. And the Lord is calling us, church, to be wise, to be smart about this thing. We don't want to labor in vain. That colleague of mine, in all the years that he has made pension contributions in this country, he cannot wait to eat any of them. He was just paying and paying and paying. Private investment, private pensions and all of that, occupational pensions. Where are all of them today? I pray you will, none of us will die before we eat the reward of our labor in Jesus' name. We need to be wise as a people. The children of this world, they are wiser than us. They will go to the gym. I have a colleague I've invited, you know, so many times to church, and he said, I will watch you on YouTube. I said, why? You can come in physically. He said, no. On my Sunday morning, Saturday morning, 3 hours at the gym. Religiously, she's 49 years. She will be 50 by next year. Religiously, she will go to the gym. I said, why are you doing this? He said, because I don't want to suffer from health problems. And regularly, she said, my gym, if an unbeliever understand that, yes, what about we? We should be wiser. And the Lord will make us wiser in Jesus' name. Quickly, I will talk to you on 4 points. Number one, the feebleness through appalling eating. Then we'll look at flabbiness through absence of exercise. Then we will look also at food for the aging experience. As you are aging, brethren, there is food for the aging experience. What you eat as a young person might not be appropriate for you when in your old age. Then finally, we will look at fitness through appropriate exercises. Let's come back to point number one. Feebleness through appalling eating. Gideon, the Bible tells us, had 300 men. And they needed to conquer. They needed to win a battle. And the Bible says they were chasing. They were chasing. They were chasing. At some point, when they got to a place, they became tired. They were fainting, and the Bible says, yet pursuing. And that is the case of some of us as Christians. We are losing stamina, and yet we are still pursuing, because we feel there are some things we have not done. Where I have that project I have not completed. I need to support my children. But you know that you are fainting. Your health is failing. The stamina is no longer there. The strength is no longer there. When we get to that situation in our lives, we need to pause and ask ourselves, why is this thing like this? Why am I getting so tired? Why am I losing strength? There's still work for me to be done. And I don't have the energy to do this thing again. What is it that I'm doing that I ought not to be doing? Because you need strength to do whatever you want to do. Even to cook in the kitchen, you need strength. And when that strength is failing, you should ask yourself. And most of the problems that we've had is because of the food that we are eating. Feebleness can come. Sickness can come when we eat in a way that we ought not to be eating. And you will see, as I see this with you, that there are some people too that ate some things they shouldn't eat in Bible days, and it affected them. If they did it back then, if we do it now, it will affect us. How much of the tiredness, breathlessness is as a result of what we are eating. The people of old ate a lot of natural foods. You know the mistakes we make? We're trying to save money. And we look at Asda. They sell cheap things. And most of these cheap things that they sell, they are not natural. They have preservatives. They have conservative. They have whatever thieves, all of the thieves you can mention. And we go there, we pack them. And we begin to eat them. We feed them to our children. 2 years ago, the Lord spoke to me, and I heard, and I stopped it, that the food you are giving to these children, even before I came to this point about health, we were always, my wife will go to Asda at that time, and we will buy all the snacks so that we can give the children on Sunday morning. We thought they are children, let them have. And the day I heard that, I told my wife, please, don't give these children these things anymore. Ah, but why? They will miss it. I know they will miss it. This thing we are giving them, I heard that it's dangerous to their health. Sugar and all those things. And we would bring it here, they will eat. The children were always, when we stopped, they thought we are evil. They thought we didn't like them, but they didn't understand that what we too cannot eat. Why give it to them? Because once they develop appetite for it, to take it away from them will be. Now, we've gone beyond that point. When we first did it, it wasn't nice. But we knew that in the long run, it is the best decision we have ever made. And it is the same thing. Most of the way we eat, the things we eat, the things we go to stores to buy, let's stop. Let's think. Come with me to Genesis chapter 1. For you to know that when God created man, the original food that God gave man to be eating, they are natural foods. Look at it in verse 29. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and everything in the which is the fruit of the tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for what? For meat. God specifically told them what caused the problem in the Garden of Eden. It wasn't gari and ebao. It wasn't yam and goat meat. It wasn't umpobi and isiewu. It was fruit. And that tells you that when God created man, man was purely, we had a vegetarian diet in the beginning. Genesis chapter 2. I read here in verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest eat freely. Can you see that? It is tree, natural food. That was how you find men living back then 300 years, 700 years. You would have wondered, how come? The secret is in the word of God. How much time, how much fruits and natural food are we eating? Today we eat a lot of processed food. With the consequences of preservative, coloring, addictive, sugar, and so on and so forth. They do all those things because it's cheaper. They do it because it's long-lasting. They do it because it's attractive. And sometimes it is very cheap. And we go there, it is so cheap to eat food in this country. That's why they will say people that comes to Obodo Oyibo, once they arrive, give them 1 year, you will see them. They will grow fat. Oh yes, we will grow fat. Because all the things that they are giving us, they are preservative. Much of the joint pains, constant breathlessness, tiredness is due to our diet. Our salt intake is raising our high blood pressure. Our sugar intake is doing immense damage to both our blood and our teeth. Do you know that sugar destroys teeth? Seriously? We take salt. Some people, if there is no salt, so much salt in the food, they will not eat it. Even when they have put salt in, they will say, bring me salt again. Some people even have Maggi, that Maggi, liquid Maggi, that they will pour inside. All is because we want sweet tea to be sweet. Why? It is dangerous to our health. And this health can be put in jeopardy if we are not careful with it. Our arteries are lined up with fat deposit because of oily and fried foods. Many of us, we eat too much fried food. We want to eat fish, we will fry it. We want to eat plantain, we will fry it. We want to eat meat, we will fry it. Something, in fact, is when we eat, sometimes when people cook soup, they will prefer to even fry the soup. Why? Brethren, we need to slow down. Tell your neighbor something will change. Tell the, this must change. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. We as a people, we are rapidly going fat and out of shape because of consuming too much carbohydrates and fat. We are eating less fruits and protein and constantly suffering from anemia, indigestion, constipation, stomach cramps, and so many other things. And sometimes we don't even pay attention. As long as this belly is not empty, we are all right. But no, there are things that young people can eat. When you are over 40 as a woman, watch your food. When you are over 50 as a man, watch what you are eating. Some people that have the tendency of growing fat, in fact, they start earlier than that. What we are eating is eating us up. What we are going through as a result of what we are eating is also going through us. Come with me quickly to 2 Kings chapter 4. Let me show you the story of these people. They were hanging out with the prophet of God, Prophet Elisha, but they failed to recognize the difference between edible food and non-edible. Look at what they did. 2 Kings chapter 4, I read here from verse 38. And Elisha came again to Gilgal, and there was a dearth. I want you to look at that dearth that we read here. You will see that there is an R before the TH. Are you there? And Elisha came again to Gilgal, and there was a dearth in that place. You see there is an R before the TH. That dearth means scarcity. It's not the death to die. So it means there was scarcity. They were lacking at that time in the land. And the sons of the prophets were sitting before him. And he said unto his servant, set on the great pot and set pottage for the sons of the prophet. And one went out. I want you to take note of verse 39. And one went out into the field to gather herbs, which was the food they were eating at that time, and found a wild vine. Take note of the word wild. It is not for consumption. And gathered thereof wild goats, his lap full, and came and shred them into the pot of pottage, for they knew them not. He didn't know the difference between these two things. He saw those vine. We eat vine now. He took it. He saw goats. We eat. He didn't know that those two, they were wild ones. And he brought them. And he shredded them. And he put them into that pot of pottage. And the people started eating. Look at what happened in verse 30. So they poured out for the men to eat. And it came to pass, as they were eating of the pottage, that they cried out and said, O thou man of God, there is what? Death. The real death now in this pot. They said, this thing we are eating will kill us. What is this thing that your servant are cooked for us? The people that cooked that thing were the servants of Elisha. They cooked it to the sons of the prophets that were at Gilgal. But here, because he had no knowledge, between the things that are edible and the things that were not edible. He took all of them. He put them in the pot and he gave it to those people. And as they were eating, they said, this thing is not feeling right in our body. We will die from eating this thing. Then look at what he did. But he said, that was the man of God. But he said, then bring meal. And he cast it into the pot. And he said, pour out for the people that they may eat. And there was no harm in the pot. If Elijah was not there, and he did not exercise the authority of the prophet over that thing that would have killed those people, every one of them would have died. Why? Because of what they ate. So the things we are eating can kill. It is not a magic. It is important that whatever we are putting in the pot for us to eat and for our children to eat, we must be sure, we must understand that, okay, this is what I need at this point in time. Otherwise, it will not be a God, why did he allow it to happen? Those people, they were with the prophets. But because they were careless, they put the health of the old people in jeopardy. And sometimes that's the mistake we too will make. I pray the Lord God of heaven will help us in Jesus' name. These people, they could have, you know, completely wiped out all the rest of this, the prophets that were, the sons of the prophets that were in Jericho, if not that Elisha intervened. There is need for us to exercise wisdom in this area of diet. It is very important. You know what the Bible says? Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. It tells us, wisdom is the principal thing. Thereof, it says we should get understanding. And in all our getting, we should get understanding. Yes, it is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. But in all your getting also, get understanding. We need to get understanding about this thing. Look at that thing that I said Sister Alice has been doing. She does it for me every time, by the way. It's not only for her husband. And I thank God for it. Every time I drank it, I slept well. I don't feel any... for whatever reason. If you don't understand, you can ask. Get information. How about this thing? How about this thing? Is it even right for us to be eating this kind of thing? Because we have no any other substitute. This health is all we need to live this life. And I pray none of our health will fail in Jesus' name. Dietary knowledge will preserve us from impaired health and untimely death. It will prevent. There are so many people that died young, not because that death wanted to come or the devil succeeded in killing them. It was essentially because of the food that they had. Some of the things we eat, they are poison. And we just put them in the pot, we just eat them just like that. But I pray, the wisdom of God will keep us alive in Jesus' name. That brings me quickly to the second point. Flabbiness through absence of exercise. We have looked at sickness that can come due to appalling heating. What about flabbiness that comes through exercise? 1 Timothy chapter 4. As I read there in verse 8. For bodily exercise profited little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. Do you know that, more often than not, people will, because of this passage, will not do exercise at all. They say that all those people that are going to the gym, didn't they read their Bible? 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. Bodily exercise profited little. For that reason, they won't do exercise at all. But they are forgetting that the Bible did not say that it did not profit at all. The Bible says it profited little. Why? In the light of eternity. Bodily exercise profited little in the light of eternity. In other words, you don't put bodily exercise in the place of godliness. He says, but there is profit in it too. Then, let's go there and take advantage of the little that is profiting. He says, godliness is profitable in all things. Having this promise in this present world and in the world to come. Of course, that's what godliness does. But bodily exercise, he profited, though little, in the light of eternity. That is what the Bible says there. And many times, many people, they will knock off exercise from their lives to their own detriment. We are growing fat. Oh, bodily exercise profited little. I'm going to heaven. We are becoming overweight. Bodily exercise profited little. I won't bother myself to go to the gym. No. No. You want to be alive, be in sound health, and to be able to do what God has called you to do. So if you need to do exercise, do it. You don't need to go to the gym to do exercise. And I will show you from the Word of God why people in the old days, apart from the food they eat, they did a lot of exercises. I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. The scriptures did not say that physical exercise has no value, but that it has little profit. Then, let's get that little, because it is useful for us. Our bodies are growing rapidly, fat, and out of shape. Flabbiness is taking over our bodies because of the absence of exercise. Our flesh, instead of being firm, but rather is dancing around like yo-yo. How many of us know what is called yo-yo? The children will know it. They play with it. It's just, you know, the thing is always floating. It's not firm. And we don't allow our body to come to that point. We don't allow. And we should not trust in medicine too much. In other words, if I am sick, if I'm not well, they will give me tablet. Tablet will cure the day. No. No, no, no. One thing I thank God for, I said it before. At the grace of God, at my age, there's no tablet that I wake up to drink every morning. No. No. None. And for some of us that are, you know, living to take tablets, maybe for high blood pressure, there are things we can do. The right food, the right drink, the right diet, the right, you know, lifestyle can change that a lot. You worry too much about too many things, drop the worry. Begin to do things that will make your health come back to high blood pressure. It's not a terminal disease that cannot be cured. It's not AIDS. It's little, you know, adjustments we need here and there. And we are fine. And I pray, in this new year, nobody will forsake here in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's quickly continue because of our time. Now, as we talk about this thing, some people, their opinion was that Jesus did not exercise. They will tell you, some Christians will tell you, where was the gym that Jesus went to? When did you hear in the Bible that Jesus exercised? It is because when they read the Bible, they don't read between the lines. And I'm going to show you. The Bible does not necessarily need to tell us that Jesus exercised or he went to the gym. And for that reason, they will not go. Come with me as we continue. These people have forgotten that Jesus and his team, they travel most of their trips on foot. They walked thousands of kilometers in the dusty, rugged terrain of ancient Palestine. Is that not more than exercise? Somebody says, how do you know? Come with me. John chapter 4. The book of John chapter 4. I'm going to show you the distance that Jesus covered on foot. If any of us can do that regularly, every fat in your body will run away. Every clotting of your arteries, all your joints, they will stretch out. These people, in their time, there was no car. There was no Okada. There was no nothing. All their trips they did on foot. Look at it. In John chapter 4, as I read from verse 1. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea. I want you to take note of the place he left. He left Judea and departed again into Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then, when he came to that city of Samaria, look at the Bible says what happened, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of the ground that Jacob gave to his son, Joseph. Now, Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied, being tired with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the ninth hour. Jesus, the Bible says, was going to from Judea to Galilee, but he needed to stop at Samaria. I checked online. The distance from Judea to Samaria was 104 kilometers. Put up the flag. Let me show you on the map. As you look at this map, this is Judea. Can you see that? Okay, this is Jerusalem. It's not very clear. You see? Now, Jesus is going to this place, Galilee. From Judea, he left here and he walked on foot. By the time he got to here, Samaria, he stopped and he continued walking, doing the work of evangelism. That was when he met that woman at the well, the woman of Samaria. He finished here and eventually he continued. Between this place and this place was 104 kilometers. Between Judea and Galilee was 210 kilometers. He did it all on foot, walking. And it wasn't like, they had any place to sleep. So you don't just sleep anyhow. Think about a man that did 104 kilometers on foot. It takes 22 hours, if you don't stop at all, 22 hours to do 104 kilometers on foot. That was the distance, walking. Think about it. Somebody that walked for a whole day, you think fat will still remain in his body? He cannot. And much more than that, this individual did not just continue walking. Look at what the Bible says in that John chapter 4. Look at in verse 31. All the dialogue between that chapter 1 was between him and that woman, how the woman went to him and he went to go and tell everybody what he has done. All that while Jesus was just walking and walking and walking, evangelizing. No, look at in verse 31. John chapter 4, verse 31. In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, do what? They told him, Abba, you have done 22 hours of walking. You got to this place now, and you are continuing to talk. You've been talking to this woman, trying to win her until now. Can't you eat something? Please, eat something. Don't kill yourself. And look at the response of Jesus. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that you know not of, which is to do this work of God. He finished there. And the Bible says he rested. After 2 days, he continued and he went to Galilee. Come with me to that chapter 4 from verse 42. For you to know what it means that Jesus, those days, they were walking all over the place. Jesus never went to gym. But he walked 22 hours to Samaria. Only God knows, maybe it took about 48 hours for him to get to Galilee, all on foot. No car, nothing whatsoever. That individual did something that most of us never did. Look at him, verse 42. And he said unto the woman, now we believe. These are all the people that the woman was evangelizing. Now we believe, not because of thy saying, for we have heard him ourselves, and know that this is indeed the Christ and the Savior of the world. Look at in verse 43. Now, after 2 days, he departed thence and went into what? Galilee. Jesus finished that work. He won that city of Samaria. He won that woman. The woman won so many other people. They too, they testified that Jesus is Lord. He said, now I have finished my work. Let's continue on our journey. And he continued. Jesus did more than exercise. He did more than going to the gym. So that kind of person cannot have flabbiness through lack of exercise. We too, we need to make simple effort. We can get up in the night, in the evening, when we have time. Just go and walk. They said 1 hour walk every day. We do the trick. We put you in perfect. And you know one thing about exercise? It does not only help the body. It helps the mental alertness too. I pray that in the new year, you will be stronger than you are this year in Jesus' name. Technology has brought so much convenience, but it has also made us not to get enough exercise. Washing machines has replaced rigorous hand washing. The oldest person in Nigeria now is 100 and something years. The oldest woman in America was 104 years. She just died about 2 weeks ago. One black woman. That the oldest in America. I said, go to Nigeria, you will see 112. Sometimes some of them, they don't even know their age. Because calendar has not come when they started living. So they don't even know. They will just tell you that I can remember that when I was born, there was no railway. I was about your age when the railway came to Nigeria. They will now look at railway came in maybe, you know, late 18 something. They will just put it together. And why? It is really exercise. Those women, they will go to the farm, they will come back, they will wash, they will do all these things. But no. Tell your children to go and wash ordinary socks now. Sock? I should wash with my hand? You don't understand. You don't understand. You should wash with your hand. Oh, that, can't we hunt the washing machine, mommy? Washing machine for socks. Why we were washing jeans in Africa with hand and we didn't die. That is what technology does. Not only that, water at the tap has replaced walking to and fro from the river, sweating with bucket on your head. It has replaced it. Today you go to the kitchen, psh, water. Brrr. How would they understand what it means to walk 3 kilometers to go and fetch water? And when you are coming, your eyes is still open. Because you know if you stumble and fall, and that water pours, you will go back again. All those things, they are part of the things that keeps us strong. They are good for the body. Not only that, brethren, lift has replaced climbing the stairs. Cars have replaced walking. By the way, they told us, Brother Friday just bought a brand new car again. So we are going to pray for that. You see, he cannot walk. He bought a new car now. Even bigger one. That's what we are saying. If all this technology, they are good. But many times they have replaced the things we ought to be doing that are good for this body. The most exercise that many of us we do these days is to flush the toilet and brush our teeth. That's all. Did you do exercise this morning? Yes. What did you do? I brushed my teeth and I flushed the toilet. Is that exercise? No. The Lord is calling us. that we need to do with all this flabbiness, this big, you know, let's do away with it. But it comes through exercise. We do things. We climb the staircase. All those many things. I didn't know that when you climb just 4 landings of stairs, you burn like 10 calories. You can imagine. Just those little things, they go a long way. Our heart pumps better. We have more energy, more strength. The more we live ourselves, the more we become weaker and more feeble. But I'm trusting God that with this natural remedy, we won't have cause to be, you know, praying and binding and losing when eventually there is sickness. The remedies are there. That brings me to the third point, quickly. Food for the aging experience. There was a story I read recently about a man that the wife turned 50. He now told the wife, "Oh, my wife, make a wish." Ah, and that one looked at him and he said, "Oh, my husband, I wish I am 10 again. I wish I could feel like I'm 10 again." The man said, "Really? All right. I'll surprise you." And the woman said, "Okay." In the morning, after he took her, they had a bath. She said, "Come, let's go together. I'll take you to somewhere." And he took the woman to the restaurant. And all the kind of food that woman had never eaten before, he said they should serve it. He served it. Everything the woman wanted, he said, "Take." He went, bought ice cream for the woman. He said, "Drink, enjoy." After, they went on this roller coaster. She said, they went, they did all those things. They came back. She said, "Let's go to the cinema." She gave her a big popcorn. She said, "Eat." And by the time he has finished doing all that and they got back home, he now asked the wife, "My wife, how did today go?" You know what the wife told him? He said, "I feel like 60. This morning when we were leaving, I was 50. But now I feel like 60. Because why? All the food that you gave me to eat is not good for me. I'm too much." There is food for the aging experience. When we are aging, there are some food that we should not be eating anymore. It's not because we are showing that we have arrived, but it only makes sense. Ice cream and all those, and sometimes they will put meat. If you see when some people are eating and see meat in their plate, it will frighten you. But we forget that our metabolisms are not the same anymore. The things you eat as a young person and you burn the fat, it's not the same. And don't forget, there is no grinding machine in your stomach. Some people, they want to eat so much meat and they don't even chew it well enough. They just swallow it. Any meat that your teeth cannot chew, pour it out. Don't swallow it. Because there is no grinder in the stomach. Teeth is the hardest, strongest thing we have inside this our mouth. And going to the belly. Any meat that your teeth cannot break, pour it out. Because it will go into your stomach, it will not digest. For the young man, it's easier. For when you are aging, it is not. Somebody was telling me about his father recently, and he said the father had constipation, and it was so serious that they took the father to the hospital, and they put something inside the father's mouth, and they extracted all the food that he ate, because it will not digest. Thank God for technology, but we don't have to do all that. Common wisdom, common knowledge will teach us that no, I can play with this kind of food. I did play with this kind of food when I was young. But now, at this age, I'm wiser. And you stay away from those kind of food. It's not only when you are fat. Sometimes you are slim, but yet there is no energy. You come to church, and I noticed that in some people. You come to church after after 1 hour, 60 minutes, they're already sleeping. It ought not to be. It ought not to be. And I am trusting God that in this new year, in fact, I will see how we are going to organize it, that we will go to Strikeleye Park. All of us, we will walk around that Strikeleye Park. We can do exercise for 1 week, just be walking around. It is good for us. Brother Jude and some other people have told me about it, that we should take our children. It should not just take our children. Even we adults, we should go there. We go and walk. It is not sinful. You are not less spiritual because you have gone to walk right around Strikeleye Park. I used to do it. I will leave my office and I will drive. I will park there in the evenings. I will go around. I've taken Paul or James on one occasion and I will go around. Suddenly, I don't know, laziness came in. I stopped. Because I would tell myself, this 1 hour that I want to go and be walking, I could be at home just resting. And that is it. All the time we want to rest. But in the new year, the devil will not deceive us anymore. Amen. Sheep, cow, goat, all they eat grass because they are herbivorous animal. Lions eat meat because they are carnivorous. Our bodily system is built in a way, and we must put appropriate food in to avoid trouble. Babies can digest milk, but the same amount of milk that babies digest easily, they drink it every morning. If adults try it, it can cause crisis for him. There are some adults here, if they drink milk, they will purge the whole day. And that tells us our systems are different. You need to understand that. Adults are meant to eat, digestive, solid food. We are eating solid food, but it must be such that we can digest. As we age, brethren, our metabolism changes, and we need knowledge in this area. Remember again, wisdom is the principal thing. In all thy getting, get wisdom. And also, understanding. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7. Our quantity of food intake must also decrease as we age, and the regularity of it is very, very important. The disciples of Jesus, they ate fresh maize. These maize are natural. They are unprocessed food. And the team ate a lot of fruits too. Remember Mark chapter 11, when Jesus cursed that fig tree. What was he looking for to find on that fig tree? Fruits. He wasn't looking for any other thing. Remember in Luke chapter 6, the Bible says the disciples went out, and when the Pharisees were accusing them that they have gone to plug corns and maize, and they rubbed it in their hand. We will not read all of that. And it shows that every time these people were eating natural foods, that's why you will find them. Nobody is falling sick. Nobody is feeble among them. The Lord will help us. We need to increase the quantity of natural food intake, vegetable, fruits, because they are healthy and they reduce, the amount of processed food intakes. It's very, very important. Some people, their metabolism are better, far better. The arrow said to me that the wife eats more than him. But when you see the wife, you would think that she doesn't eat at all. Because she digests. He said, if I eat like my wife, I can die. He said, that's why I eat little every time. Little. Because I know my thing doesn't digest. But my wife, she's just so blessed with that. Me too. I eat more than my wife. But I'm bigger anyway. But the truth of the matter is that whatever we are eating, let it be such that we understand your system. Since I came back from that experience that I had, my attitude has been changing for a while, but even more so, it has changed drastically. And I said to myself, it's not about size. Sometimes. But if you know that you are over, one thing about it is that when you stand on the scale, if you go to the GP and you stand on the scale, he looks at your age, looks at your height, looks at your weight, he will tell you if you are overweight or not. He'll tell you for somebody of your age, of your height, with this weight, no, it should not be. It should be less than that. And if you take it seriously, you work on it, you can bring yourself to the right weight. Because they said weight problem, once it is taken away from any sickness, that sickness is easy to cure. And I pray that the wisdom to feed not just ourselves, but also our household, the right food so that we can stay alive, the Lord will give to us in Jesus' name. Why do you think Africans are always running after African food and doing all those things? It's not because it is cheap. It is because they know it is better. I want to eat vegetable. I don't want to. Not the ones that they are put in the freezer for long. I want to eat things that are really, really fresh. That's how we were taught in Africa. It's when we came to this country that we see that they are doing canned food, processed food. Who give you canned food in Africa to eat? And all those things is telling on them. Thank God for us in the church. We've not had that problem. But when you go out there and you see the kind of, even in the U.S., if you see people that are suffering from weight in the U.S., it will shock you. It will shock you. They said that population is overweight. When they say a population is overweight, and they said after the U.S., it is this country again. It is this country again. One thing we cannot take away from Italians is that when it comes to food, when it comes to exercise, they know Italian summer is bicycle everywhere. Good food, they know how to eat. Go to Spain, you find the same thing. But this country that we are, we need to talk to ourselves about it so that this problem that they are facing, we don't let it rub on us. And it will not rub on us in Jesus' name. So that is very important. We don't have the attitude of those people in the days of Isaiah. In Isaiah, you know, when they said that, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. So when they put food in front of them, they will put plenty of food. They will tell them, why are you eating like this? You have one life to live. Let me just enjoy it. And they will eat and eat and eat and say, tomorrow they die. What if you don't die and you are suffering from health problems? What if you don't die and you cannot breathe? But you are alive, but you are struggling. The Lord will help us. That brings me quickly to the final point. Fitness through appropriate exercises. Physical exercise is good for physical fitness. That's why it is appropriate, if we want to be physically fit, to carry out the job, to carry out everything, to wait and live enough to see in our lifetime that our children are raising up children. And you can pour of yourself into your grandchildren. It's a thing of joy. It's what me I live for every day. That I can, you know, see my grandchildren come, you know, up. And I'm well enough to take them out. I'm well enough, strong enough to babysit them. There's no greater joy. So physical fitness, we need that. But by the same token, if you are going to be spiritually fit, you need to exercise also spiritually. That's why the Bible says that we should not be slothful in business. We should be fervent in spirit. We should be serving the Lord. So it is important that if we want to be fit physically, we will make sure that we take physical exercise seriously. We want to be fit spiritually. We take spiritual exercise seriously. We need to keep fit through adequate and appropriate exercises. We need simple exercises that will help our hearts to pump well. They call that cardiac exercises. Somebody says, my heart is not pumping well. You can Google it. What are the kind of exercises I can do that can help my heart to be pumping well? Cardiac exercises is good that your heart pumps very well. Exercises that will help your lungs. They are aerobic exercises. Breathing, you're having breathing problems. Aerobic exercises will do the magic for you. Exercises that will help us to burn fat. They are calories exercises. You are doing all that and you are burning calories. You are not just the... Because calories, as they accumulate and accumulate, it becomes a problem. Weight will be the thing. Excess fat will be the problem. Exercises that will help us to work our joints. They are flexible exercises. As you are aging, some people, they cannot squat, you know, squat and they cannot go down, and their joints is always aching. Exercises, those flexible exercises, they help the joints. You stretch out small, small. You don't need just do it bit by bit. Be regular with it. All those joints that cold and is gone in and is like you cannot stretch it. Some people, once they cannot stretch it, they say, this is my hand. I cannot stretch it. I didn't do anything with it. And they will leave it like that. Don't stretch your hand. That is as far as it can go. No. If God intended that your hand should stretch completely, it should stretch like this. When you have not broken it, then you should know that it's because you need some exercise. The leg, the same thing. You do it bit by bit. All those joints, they will free up. Exercises that will help us to tone our muscles. They are muscular exercises. Brethren, it is true that the Bible says bodily exercise profited little. But we need to go and get that little for our own profit, because it helps us to live better. If we have time to go to the gym, thank God for it. If we don't, just 30 minutes of structured exercises per day will do the magic. 30 minutes, 1 hour. If you don't know, the things are there on this thing, on YouTube and all those things. You can ask and you will get the information. That brings me to the story of that man, David Brainerd. This guy was an American missionary, and he did so much. Historian says that this individual lived 29 years, 5 months, and 19 days. That was all he lived. But he did so much. Up to today, Google his name, you will see. He influenced the people of his generation in 29 years of his life. Not adult life, his entire life. So by the time he even started, maybe he was around 15 or 18, and he lived just 29 years. But at the end of the life of that man, look at what he says. He says, I have killed the horse. That was his physical body. And now I cannot go on at 29 years. He says, I have killed this body. Only God knows what he did with that body. He said, this is the horse, and I have killed it. I can't go any further. Think about if that man had lived longer, what he would have done for the Lord, and for his children, and for his grandchildren. But he never lived all that, because he killed the horse. Many of us, the way we are living, we are killing this body. When the body needs rest, let's give it a rest. If it is to give it exercise, let's give it exercise. If it is to feed it well with things that will nourish it and will not be a poison, let's do that. That's why you will find people in their 80s, they are still strong, sound mind. Sometimes I listen to some people on TV or maybe in the news, and some of them are writers, some of them are preachers, and you can still see their mind still sound. They outline things, they articulate things very well, and you'll be wondering at her. While you will find some people here, you know, maybe in their 60s, already they have dementia, and they are at the sick home. It's not a place for you. You will not go there in Jesus' name. Discipline to maintain the exercise regime is important in order to get results. Good food and adequate exercise will empower the physical body to function at its best. The intake of good food, that is when it comes to spiritual food, and adequate spiritual exercises like devotion, praying, fasting, evangelism, worship, will empower the spirit to function at its best. So you see, there is appropriate exercise for everything that we need. As I round up, I think it was, the story is still on YouTube. The woman was an 82-year-old woman. And this woman, she used to be a bodybuilder. And she was still training, even in her, you know, into her 80s. So one day she was home, and a burglar came into her home. Ironically, the burglar is 28 years old. Think about it. A young man burgled into the house of an 82-year-old woman. And you will not believe it. She told the story. She said when that burglar came in and she saw that the burglar had come in and she was all alone. Maybe that burglar, a young man of 28, he has been seeing the woman. He said, I'm going to teach this old woman a lesson. And he thought she's a push around. And that burglar came into the house of that woman. I don't know what she did. Maybe it's taekwondo or whatever she did. And she put that 28-year-old boy on the ground. And that boy was on the ground. Maybe he hits him by the balls or kick him by the, I don't know. And he kept that boy on the floor. And he held phone with another hand and was calling the police. And called the police. And she was holding that 28-year-old on the ground till the police came. When the police came, they were surprised. They were surprised that, was somebody in this house with you? She said, no. And you are holding this young man on the ground. If you are a young man, it's better you have strength. Because the day you will be rude to one old person, then you will know, you don't know some of them, what they have been through in life. And the police came eventually, took that young man. And they came back to come and interview that woman. And she now showed them her belt, all her with bodybuilding. And she said, yes, that she could have done even, she could have done worse to that young man. Was just that. And that is something that can happen. And I'm trusting God that even in our old age, the Lord will keep us strong. You know what the Bible says? As your days are, so shall thy strength be. I pray that passage will be fulfilled in your life in Jesus' name. Let's rise up on our feet and call upon the Lord. I was looking at the time. Our time is fast spent. But we need to pray. Let's thank God. Let's thank the Lord for health. Let's bless the name of the Lord for how he has, you know, given us all this sound health. Many of us, we are not on the hospital bed. Many of us, we are well. We have the covenant, oh yes, of healing. Magnify the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Thank the Lord. Oh, yes, because in the mercy of God, he has kept you and I alive. He has kept you and I strong. He has kept you and I, oh, yes, in sound and perfect health. Bless the name of the Lord. Magnify the name of the Lord. Pray that, oh, yes, sickness will not be your portion. It will not be your portion. It will not be your portion. In the name of the Lord Jesus, open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. That, oh yes, God, I thank you for this health. I thank you because I am well and I'm alive. I thank you for the covenant of healing over my life, my wife, my children, my entire household. I bless your name, Lord, for how you have continued to keep us, protect us from the sicknesses that is destroying the people of this very age. You said the sickness that you have put upon the Egyptians, they will not come upon your children. I thank you for living in the reality of that promise. In the name of the Lord Jesus, accept my thanks, accept my gratitude, accept my praise. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, we prayed. In Deuteronomy chapter 33, I'm reading there in verse 25. The Bible says, thy shoes shall be iron and brass. I didn't hear your amen. In other words, the shoe you will wear, it shall be iron and brass. You will trample upon everything. None of them will hurt you in Jesus' name. He now concluded, as thy days, so shall thy strength be. You are going to call upon the Lord. That the older you get, the healthier you will be. The older you get, the stronger you will be. The older you get, the more sounded you will be. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. As my days are, so shall my strength be. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I am 40 now. As I grow 50, I will be stronger. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I will be healthier. In the name of the Lord Jesus, remember Caleb. When he stood and he said to Moses, give me that mountain. He said, as I was young back in those days, so I am now. Even in your life, talk to the Lord. That as your days are, so shall your strength be in the name of Jesus. Talk to the Lord. Strength every day. Strength every day. Sound health every day. In the name of the Lord Jesus, the Lord will do it in your life. Sickness will not cut short of your life. In the name of the Lord Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. We want to call upon the Lord that your health will not fail. You see, the devil, through all these things that we have talked about this morning, appalling eating, lack of exercises, the wrong food in the wrong time, he is setting a trap. He knows he cannot inflict you with sickness because you have the covenant of God. But he's using your appetite to push you into that trap. But this morning you are going to pray. That the trap of sickness, the pit of sickness that the devil is setting, you will not fall into it. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Through your eating, through your lifestyle, through your habits, call upon the Lord. In the name of the Lord Jesus, oh Lord, help me that I will not fall into this trap of sickness, this pit of sickness due to lack of exercise. Due to appalling eating, due to, oh yes, my lifestyle, lack of exercise. Oh Lord, here I pray this morning, I will not fall into the pit of sickness. I will not fall into the trap. In the name of the Lord Jesus, call upon the Lord, that the Lord God of heaven, he will do it in your life, in my life, in the name of the Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name, we pray. We want to finally call upon the Lord. You see, there was something you noticed about the patriarchs of this faith. Every one of them lived to see their children's grandchildren. Abraham lived to see Isaac get married, raise up children. Isaac lived to see Jacob, and Jacob lived to see Joseph. You will live to see your grandchildren. You are going to call upon the Lord. That by the grace of God, by the power of God, by the healing virtue of Christ, you will live to see your children's children. Open your mouth and call upon the Lord. Talk to the Lord in prayer. Oh yes. You will not die. Oh yes. Before your children will get married, you will not die. Before your children will raise up will raise up children. You will not die to heed the before you heed the reward of your labor. In the name of the Lord Jesus, call upon the Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. You will not die. I say you will not die. Amen. You will see your children in Jesus' name. Amen. We saw the life of Jesus Christ going up and down, preaching the gospel. You will preach the gospel in Jesus' name. Amen. Our faithful God, we just thank you for your blessing this morning. We thank you because you are a God that changeth not. You are the I am that I am, the God of all universe. We bless your name for the way you have blessed us through your word this morning. Lord, and my God, we pray that you will give us long life in Jesus' name. We pray that, Lord, as your word has come forth this morning, we pray that all every one of us will see our children, we will see our great children, Lord, in Jesus' name. None of us will bury our young one in Jesus' name. Lord, and my God, as this year is going to our end, every one of us will cross over to the year 2000 in Jesus' name. Whatsoever the plans of the enemy, whatsoever the devil might have planned concerning any one of our life, we cancel every plans of the enemy tonight in Jesus' name. We commit your servant unto your care. We ask that, Lord, as he has preached the word of God to every one of us this morning, we go out and practicalize it in next week in Jesus' name. We commit him unto your care once again. We pray that your mighty hand will be upon him in Jesus' name. We pray that you will continue to strengthen him more and more in Jesus' name. We cover him and his family with your precious blood. As he go out, Lord, we pray that you will keep him and protect him in Jesus' name. Lord and my God, as we go out this week, we pray that you will bless every one of us in Jesus' name. And we pray that we put testimony in every one of our mouth in Jesus' name. Thank you, faithful God, you have answered. We bless, we worship your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Can we share the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the true fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life, and we dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. And the ocean